Republican vice presidential candidate and Wisconsin Congressman Paul Ryan campaigning in the swing state of Virginia on Friday. Wisconsin law says you can't run for two offices at once unless one of them is president or vice president. So Paul Ryan will remain on the ballot in the first congressional district. How does this affect the campaign of his Democratic opponent? We're joined now by Rob Zerban, the Kenosha businessman and former county supervisor challenging Paul Ryan in the first district. Good to have you back on the program. We appreciate it.
Thanks, Mike.
So how does this affect your campaign? Does it make it more difficult? Does it make it easier? What happens?
Well, it doesn't change my campaign a whole lot. You know, I'm in this campaign for the same reasons today that I was from the first day I started the campaign. It certainly does bring a different attention to the race and is certainly going to highlight the Ryan budget, as you've seen since the pick, that people are picking it apart, so to speak.
How do you engage Paul Ryan when he's off traveling around the country running for a different office? You know, the media, let's be honest, the media likes conflict. There's not likely to be a lot of conflict in your race since one of the candidates won't be here.
That's true. And one of the things people always ask me is, are you going to have the chance to debate him? And I would certainly love that opportunity. And I think if he feels he can run for two offices at the same time, he should be back here to run a campaign against me and debate me on issues that are important to the people here in the first.
Yeah, you've said the Ryan selection hasn't really affected what you're going to do, mm-hmm. but it has affected how others perceive this race. What has been the impact on your campaign?
Well, it certainly, like I said, brought a lot more attention to it, yeah. and the various aspects of the Ryan budget are going to be front and center. You know, the Ryan kill Medicare budget, making it a voucher program, and also the, you know, cutting veterans funding by 24%, getting rid of things that I benefited from, like Pell Grants and Stafford loans. People are going to look at these things, and I think once they see them, the budget for what it is, then they're not only going to reject Paul Ryan and Mitt Romney at the top of the ticket, but also down the ballot in my congressional race.
Let's talk about your criticism of his Medicare proposal. Mm-hmm. He describes it as a premium support proposal. You give money to people and under the age of 55, and they can choose to the insurance they want, buy insurance. Some people call it a voucher. Mm-hmm. You do. What's the Democratic alternative to the money problems facing Medicare, which many analysts predict could be in serious trouble in 10 or 12 years from now?
Well, look, the Democratic position, or my position, is that I support Medicare and in its current form. And there are a lot of things that we can do to make sure that Medicare is solvent in its current form. Ask any Republican who's on it, any Democrat, overwhelmingly they support the Medicare program to the tune of almost 90%, feel it works very well. If we need to address costs associated with it, we need to go back and redo things like Medicare Part D, which the Republicans passed, where they gave up the right to negotiate for the price of prescription drugs. This is really irresponsible kind of legislation, where they gave Big Pharma a big gift. And those are the kind of things we need to go back and change before we ask senior citizens to pay more out of their pocket to the tune of about $6,500 a year.
Don't you have to look at the fundamental changes, though, like raising the age for eligibility, things like that? Don't we have to look at that?
I think when you're trying to find a solution to any problem, everything should be on the table, but some things just absolutely are not negotiable with my candidacy. I support Medicare for all, and that's an important aspect. As a business owner, it makes sense. I would have gladly paid more into Medicare as a contribution and have my employees have the ability to take care of that program or participate in that program than to have my insurance rates go up 18% year over year. And that was one of the largest expenses I had as a business owner, was these out of control rates for insurance.
Give me a sense of what's the priority, your priority, in terms of attacking the nation's debt problem. Mm-hmm. Well, what needs to be done first? Where do we find a lot of money in order to address this?
Well, some of the things that need to happen are, we need to let the Bush tax cuts expire for the wealthiest people in this nation. We need to get rid of oil and gas subsidies in our budget that Paul Ryan keeps in there to the tune of about $40 billion a year. These are the ways we go about getting our house in fiscal order.
Aren't those small amounts of money, those small pockets of money, compared to what is really needed to be done?
I don't think $40 billion is a small amount, Mike. And I don't think...
But when you're talking trillions in debt...
Well, we know that the Ryan budget has got misplaced priorities. We know that it's based in fiction. You know, it's based upon 2.8% unemployment. It's based upon getting discretionary spending down from 12% of GDP to about 3% of GDP, which nobody looks at these things as realistic possibilities. So I'm willing to have a conversation about it. I'm willing to use my business experience of writing responsible budgets and balancing benefits in the bottom line to take that to Washington, D.C. and work hard as I've done in my career. I'll work hard for the people to make sure we move in the right direction.
Give me a sense of your willingness to reach across the aisle. A lot of people talk about our polarized politics. How do you feel about that?
I think it's true. You know, particularly here in Wisconsin, I think a lot of people are upset with politicians just always flapping their jaws and not really focusing on solutions. That's why Congress's approval is the lowest it's ever been. One thing Paul Ryan and I do agree on is that people are ready to be talked to as adults and have an honest debate and conversation regarding how to move the country forward. And what I would encourage Republicans and Democrats alike, look at the Ryan budget. Really look at it and decide what it is you like about it and what it is you don't like about it, and ask him the tough questions. I didn't author it, but a lot of people look at this and say, this is not a serious budget. It does not get us in our fiscal house in order. And we have duties and obligations as citizens to be educated, to make informed decisions. And I think that's what I would like to see happen in this campaign.
Rob Zerban is the Democratic candidate in the 1st Congressional District race. It's good to have you back on the program. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mike.
Next, Paul Ryan and the Tea Party.